We're now in the law firm of Chinoye Edmond Obiago. He's also the co-founder of Legal Defense and Assistance Project, and he's the advocate on this edition of Legal Focus. So let's begin from your childhood years, especially the moment you knew you were going to be a lawyer.
Well, I came out from secondary school and I decided to be a philosopher. So, because I was thrilled by philosophical books I've read, especially Friedrich Nietzsche, Friedrich Engel, and Karl Marx. And I enrolled to study philosophy in the University of Nigeria in Nsukka. And I did. Second year into my study as a philosophy student, I was involved in student union activities. And for some reason, we were arrested and thrown into the prisons. And that was in 1982. And I was in Onitsha prison for 9 months as a result of everybody knew what happened then when there was a rustication of University of Ife students and NAMS mobilized nationwide.
So this was a solidarity protest.
Exactly. And due to the protest that took place, we were arrested. And my sojourn to the prison perhaps changed my perception about justice. Also, when I was young, as a young person, my father died, and there was a lot of injustice in the community, in which, you know, my relations, my parents, my mother, my brothers and sister, myself, were accused by the relations of being responsible, and which we all know was not true. And again, I was also arrested, and I saw a lot of injustice going on. So, coupled my background as a philosophy student, I decided that law should be a better instrument to fight justice in society. So I graduated in 1985 from University of Nigeria in Nsukka, with a degree in philosophy, and then quickly enrolled to study law at University of Ibadan. And that was how I started my journey as a lawyer.
Absolutely. And then looking at these two major instances, your family experience, your family issues now, and the 9 months in jail, let's just know, how did this period end for you? Did it end well? Did these two scenarios, you know, end well for you?
Yes, they did. It ended very well because it ended as an inspiration. It ended as a young man who was understanding society. I was barely 16, 17 then. And it inspired me to look at society as very unjust, because I saw a lot of people who were in prison for doing nothing, or even for simple civil disputes, or just for persecution. So it gave me an inspiration. And even when I became a lawyer, my area of practice had always been on fight for social justice. And that's why immediately I graduated from law firm, from the law, I had a stunt in Ibadan before I now joined the Civil Liberties Organization and Mr. Lisabakoba's firm. And that's the beginning of my work as a public interest lawyer.
Let's also build up on that, you know, period of tutelage. I understand under the Olusegun Agbakoba chambers now. What was that period like, and are there other legal influences, you know, that you can identify with in your training as a lawyer?
Yes, I had two mentors in law. One is Michael Johansson in Ibadan, who taught me basics about legal writing. And then I moved on during the June 12 crisis to Lagos and joined the Sabakova. And that was when I strengthened my conviction about social justice, by using the law to fight social justice. Because then I was a founding member of Hori Laws, which was the public interest arm of Olusegun Agbakoba's firm, and who descended on prisons. And we are working on dealing with cases of persons in prisons who have stayed for a long time. And I was amazed to see that people were in prison awaiting trial for 15 years, some to 20 years, completely forgotten by society. And people who are in the middle class don't even understand that, because all the people you see in prisons are poor people, people who are barely educated, and so on. So that was an inspiration for me. And Mr. Agbakoba provided that platform, because he created the legal instrument to fight for justice. So even though we have commercial practice in the firm, my focus was on public interest law in that firm. And I was there till 1998, in a period of about 6 or 7 years. By then we have built a very good jurisprudence on human rights in this country. Cases like Peter Nemi and Attorney General of Lagos State, Ogugu and the state, and all that, where the Supreme Court affirmed the supremacy of constitutional rights. Ulisa Abokoba and the SSS was a case about the rights of movement. It was a case that we litigated. So many others. And having that foundation and a jurisprudential understanding of law as an instrument for social justice, I, with my friends and colleagues, set up Legal Defense and Assistant Project, basically to use the law to defend human rights.
In the midst of all these experiences now, what would you describe as the highs and the low points?
Well, the high point for me is usually the individual cases. I mean, we've assisted hundreds and hundreds of people in prison, you know. But there are some instances where you know you have achieved justice, and for you, you are very contented. There are so many instances I can describe. I can tell you a case of a young boy in Benin who was driving his master, and he was owed salaries. And his master went to the bank, withdrew money, and was owing him 3 months' salary. And he collected the bag of money, counted his salary, and ran away. And the master reported him to the police. The police arrested him and charged him for armed robbery. And he was convicted and sentenced to death and thrown to Oko Prison in Benin. His name Monday Ilade Prosper. We intervened, and I was able to, you know, do his case and convince the Court of Appeal that that could not be an armed robbery, but that could not be stealing, because he thought he was taking what belonged to him. He didn't take beyond the salary that was owed. So Monday Ilade Prosper was barely 18 years when this happened, but he came out from prison at age 31. And I saw him, he's now located to Anambra State where he's a farmer. So when I see people like that living a new life, that's a high point for me, actually, and I feel very glad. There are so many other instances that you can see on our website, including William Sowodo, who was a young boy, you know, thrown into prison, had no one to bear him or to defend him. Incidentally, these cases, for some reasons, they are convicted and they're thrown into prison. They are sentenced to death. So we think that death penalty, and that's why we started a campaign against the death penalty, that death penalty is very risky because our justice system has not been able to deliver justice. And therefore, a system that cannot deliver justice should not take life.
And does this give you a sense of, you know, defeat when you are confronted, or when you put your passion now against the inadequacies in our legal system? Does it give you a sense of defeat, or how do you feel?
Exactly, it does. And that's also as an inspiration, because when we understand the deficiencies in our legal system, especially the criminal justice system, basically the reliance on confessions, and we know that confessions most times are involuntary. We did a study that almost 90% of armed robbery cases, convictions are based on confessional statements. So we're inspired to begin to campaign for law reforms. Incidentally, our voices were heard. In 2003, the then Attorney General, Akinolu Olujimi, appointed me to chair a committee to revise criminal justice laws. That is the National Working Group on the Reform of Criminal Justice. That was the highest point for me, because it was a recognition of our work. And the committee met. We had other people like Professor Yemi Akinseye, Judge Fola Towori, current Justice of the Supreme Court, Justice Isi Nweze, Helen Ogumiju, who is now at the Court of Appeal. And then they were at the High Court. So we came together, produced this bill, and many others, Tunde Fapohunlu and so on, Norrison Quakers. So we produced the bill, which is we called the Administration of Criminal Justice Bill, 2005. Which eventually, after 10 years, was passed into law as the Administration of Criminal Justice Act, 2015. So for us, for me personally, it was the highest achievement in my life, because I was able to put into the law books those gaps I noticed my 20 plus years of practice as a criminal litigation lawyer. And when the Nigerian Bar Association, last 2018, honored me, you know, and the organization led up as the foremost criminal justice reformer at the conference in Asaba, it was also a high point for us. In other words, the experiences we gain on the field, defending rights of people who are in conflict with the criminal law, inspired us to reform criminal justice. And that is why the AGJA, Additional Criminal Justice Law, is in place, not just at the Federation, but also across the states. About 23 or so states have adopted the Additional Criminal Justice Law.
Tell us about your emergence as a senior advocate of Nigeria.
Well, it was, for me, a recognition of a contribution to law development in this country. I've applied to be a senior advocate for 4 years, and being from Anambra State, it's always very competitive for candidates from Anambra and Ogun State because of the high numbers of applicants from those states. But eventually, in 2018, I was selected and conferred with the honor. And I think it is a call for duty to mentor younger lawyers, to drive reforms in our system, and to deepen our criminal justice jurisprudence. And that's the task we set ourselves to do in the coming years.
Okay, and when talking about reforming the criminal justice system, there's also an expectation now, based on what one sees out there, that is really the lawyers who drive the system, good or bad. But then, does it concern you that, you know, some lawyers might actually, you know, also be behind now this abuses we see in the system?
Definitely. And that's why we're worried that the legal disciplinary procedures are not very efficient. We've seen lawyers responsible directly for abuses, especially of vulnerable groups. And that's why we participated in the passing of the Vulnerable Violence Against Persons Prohibition Act and the Anti-Torture Act 2017. These two laws try to direct abuses targeted at women, children, and vulnerable persons, like disabled persons. And we see lawyers even encouraging police, for instance, to make arrests where there's a civil dispute, you know, intervening when they're not supposed to intervene. But I think the law is sufficient to discipline lawyers who are not using the law to promote justice. They're using the law to abuse vulnerable people. What is lacking is that our legal profession has not sufficiently strengthened its disciplinary systems. Because if it does, lawyers will refrain from abusing the rights of people.
All right, an advocate of Nigeria, Mr. Chinoye Edmond Obiago, we appreciate your time with us on Legal Focus. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kevin.
And the program continues right here on TVC News. Stay with us.